जियोलॉजिकल नॉलेज। सो टुडे वी विल डिस्कस वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक रिलेटेड टू स्ट्रक्चरल जियोलॉजी, दैट इज द सीयर जोन्स। ओके, एंड दैट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक फॉर द पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन एज वेल एज फॉर द कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जाम्स। वेदर यू आर टेकिंग दिस टॉपिक इन द वाइल टेकिंग योर डिग्री और कंप्लीटिंग योर डिग्री और पीजी और यूजी क्लासेस और ड्यूरिंग द प्रिपरेशन ऑफ द कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जाम्स। Questions are generally asked from this topic, and this is very important for you to understand the basics behind the shear zones, their classification, their occurrence, and how they are forming. Okay, and the most importantly, the shear zones indicators. Okay, so I mean that what are the indicators from where we can define the movement? Okay, or the shearing indication. Okay. So let's start our discussion. So firstly, we will understand that what are the shear zones. So shear zones can be defined as the planar or the curvy planar zones of high deformation, which are long relative to their width. Okay, they are the planar or the curvy planar zones of high deformation, which are long relative to their width. Means their length is higher than the width, okay, and which are surrounded by rock showing a lower state of finite strain. Means the shear zones, they are the planes or planar or curvy planar zone of highest deformation and which are long relative to their width, and they are surrounded by the rocks showing a lower state of finite strain. Okay, and it's very important for you to understand that the basic differences between a fault zone, there are two zones, means fault zone as well as the shear zone. So the basic difference is the that is the most fault planes are associated with a zone of crust or the altered rocks, and these zones are called the fault zones. But when several parallel fault occur close together, the resulting zone of broken and the crust material or the crust rock, that is known as the shear zone. Okay, and a shear zone differs from a fault zone in that no distinct fault plane can be detected because here the local deformation is ductile. So what is the difference between fault zone as well as the shear zone? So shear zone differs from fault zone that there is no distinct fault plane can be detected because here the local deformation is ductile type. Okay, and the fault zone and shear zone varies greatly in width as well as in some cases they are measured in hundreds to thousands of meters. Okay, so that is the basic difference between fault and the shear zone, and this difference in fault and shear zone is generally asked in the personality test or the interview while you are going for the interview. So these differences, okay, between fault zone or the shear zone, not only in fault zone and shear zone, some other differences in your subject, these are also very important for the interview purpose. Okay, so let's continue our discussion. And how the nomenclature was given? So earlier the term shear zone, that was used to indicate only the zone of ductile shearing. Okay, earlier the term shear zone that was dedicated or that was only used to indicate the zone of ductile shearing only. But Ramsey in 1980, he has included both the ductile shearing as well as the brittle faulting process in the definition of the shearing. Or definition of the shear zone. Okay, so according to him, shear zones can be broadly classified into three types, as you can see in the diagram. That is the brittle type deformation, brittle zone, shear zone, brittle ductile shear zone, or the ductile shear zone. And what happens in these types of zones? So firstly, the ductile shear zone. So where the deformation state varies continuously from wall rock wall to wall across the zone. Okay, so in ductile shear zone, the deformation state that varies continuously from wall to wall across the shear zone. Okay, and in case of brittle shear zone, where the walls are separated by a clearly defined discontinuity of fracture surface, means as you can see in the diagram, that is in the brittle shear zone, the discontinuity, okay, the walls of the rock, they are separated by a clearly defined discontinuity of fracture surface. Okay, but in case of ductile shear zone, there is no such plane. Okay, no such discontinuity plane which distinguishes between these two planes. And in case of brittle ductile shear zone or the brittle ductile faults, so where the tangential or the wall parallel movement along the zone is associated with both the ductile shearing as well as the brittle shearing or the brittle type of faulting. So that zone is known as the brittle ductile shear zone. And if we talk about some other facts about the brittle ductile shear zone or the attributes of the brittle ductile shear zone, so they are greatly attributed to brittle failure that is controlled by the limiting elastic properties of the rock under stress conditions where the shear zone walls are almost unstrained or brecciated. Okay, and what happens during the process of ductile brittle ductile shearing zone, the wall rock up to a distance of few meters on either sides of the fault break show some ductile deformation or the permanent strain. Okay, during the process of brittle ductile deformation or brittle ductile shear zone, the wall rock up to a distance of few meters on either side of the fault break show some ductile deformation or the permanent strain. And there is another type of brittle ductile shear zone is the extension failure or the extension openings that are usually filled with the fibrous crystalline material. Okay, the extension failure or the extension openings, they are generally or usually filled with the fibrous crystalline material. And the opening between them, they are generally making an angle of 30 to approximately more than that, in range of 30 to 45 degrees with the shear zone, and sometimes showing a sigmoidal form. Okay, and in case of ductile shear zone, the deformation and the differential displacement of the wall is accomplished entirely by ductile flow. Okay, and in the some scale of rock outcrop, no discontinuity can be seen. And according to Ramsey in 1980, in many regions, the ductile and brittle ductile shear zones may be the deep level counterparts of the brittle shear zones and faults seen at high level in the crust. Okay, this is the diagram of brittle ductile shear zone. Okay, there are four diagrams named as A, B, C, D, as you can see in the brittle shear zone. In the in the figure A, you can see the brittle shear zone. There is a plane of discontinuity. And in the brittle ductile shear zone, you can see the movement of the blocks. Okay, or the ductile shear zone, only the bending. Okay, and in the tabular zone of aneclon veins. Aneclon veins means the overlapping of the veins, as you can see in the diagram D, overlapping of veins. The theoretical work on the shear localization that indicated a shear zone narrows with increasing deformation. Okay, so theoretical works which have been done, so they show a localization indicated that a shear zone narrows with the increasing deformation and ultimately reaching zero with the corresponding rupture. And if there is no aspect of the deformation, such as grain size, which will impose a non-zero material width, non-zero minimal width. Okay, thus the shear zone becomes progressively narrower. So that is the final result, that is the shear zone becomes progressively narrower towards the end, ultimately forming the thrust faults separating the nappes. Okay, in the previous video of the objective geology videos, we have discussed about the nappe, the clipe and the outliers in layers. Okay, so if you have not watched that video, you can watch that video in the playlist. The most common type of brittle ductile shear zone, that is fault in which the wall rock show dragging effect. Okay, so most common type of brittle ductile shear zone, that is the zone, a fault in which the wall rock that shows the drag effects. And tabular zones with anecline sigmoidal tension gases produced by a bulk tangential movement have also been included by Ramsey within a category of brittle ductile shear zone. Okay, so a tabular zone that has the anecline sigmoidal tension gases, anecline vanes, as we have discussed, the overlapping of the vanes. Okay, so with the sigmoidal tension gases that has been produced because of the bulk tangential movement of the material, that has been also included within the category of brittle ductile shear zone. Okay, with respect to deformation of the wall rock, the ductile shear zones are of two types, means the basis of the classification is the deformation of the wall rock. With respect to the deformation of the wall rock, ductile shear zone has again classified in two types. First one is the discrete shear zones, which cut across rocks otherwise undeformed by the particular phase of deformation, and second one is the shear zones, one or both walls of which have undergone the penetrative deformation during the development of the shear zone itself. So first one is the discrete shear zones, which have cut across the rocks otherwise undeformed by the particular phase of deformation, and second one is the shear zones, one or both wall rocks which have undergone a penetrative deformation during the development of the shear zone itself. A ductile shear zone is long narrow zone within which dominantly ductile deformation has caused a localization of the large strain. Okay, so in the case of long narrow zone, in the ductile shearing, the dominantly ductile deformation has taken place and which has caused the localization of the large strain. The formation of ductile shear zone that is commonly associated with a drastic reduction of large of the grain size. Okay, the formation of ductile shear zone that is commonly associated with a drastic reduction of grain size and the development of the well banded and lineation rock. Okay, well banded and the lineated rock. And if we talk about the shear zone rocks, the main rocks developed in the shear zone, so ductile shear zone often characterized by the presence of myelonites, and these are very important some factors or important parameters in the classification of shear zones, that is the myelonites, cataclysites, fault breaks here, gauze. Okay, so we will discuss one by one. And Lapworth had described the rock, that is myelonitized rock, in these words, following way: the most intense mechanical metamorphism occurs along the grand dislocations or the thrust planes. So what he told, that's the most intense mechanism of the metamorphism that occur along the grand dislocation thrust, along the thrust planes, where the gneisses and the pegmatites resting on those planes are crushed or dragged and ground out in a finely laminated schist rock, composed of shattered fragments of the original crystals of the rocks set in a cement of secondary quartz. Okay, and the lamination being defined by the minute enclosing lines, that is the flexion line of kaolinite and the chloritic material and secondary material of the mica. So what I mean to say is that he defined the myelinitization process, the most intensive mechanical metamorphism which has occurred along the grand dislocations or the thrust planes, where the gneisses and the pegmatites which are resting on the planes that have been crushed, dragged or the ground out into a finely laminated cyst, which is composed of the shattered fragments of original crystals of the rock, which are set in a matrix or the cement of secondary quartzite, the lamination being defined by a minute lines, flexion lines or the flexion lines of kaolinite, kaolinitic material, chloritic material and the secondary crystal materials of the mica. Okay, faulting in near surface conditions often produce fault breccia, microbreccia and the gauze. Okay, so when we were discussing the second or third part of fault classifications, we have discussed about the fault breccia, gauze or the silicon sites or the myelinites. Okay, so there we have discussed about this. These are initially incohesive material but may be later become coherent by the precipitation of minerals by circulating solution, that is the silicified or calcified fault breccia. Okay, so what is fault breccia or gauze? So fault breccia, that shows angular fragments of different sizes that occur in a pulverized ground mass. Okay, so in the objective series we have discussed that angular fragments which are embedded in a matrix of finely ground material, ground rocks, that is known as fault breccia. Okay, and the fragment size of fault breccia, that can range from microscopic to the several centimeters, and secondary minerals such as the quartz, calcite or sometimes pyrite, that can fill the spaces within the fault breccias. And when the forces are very severe, as in the frequently the case in the thrusting, the rocks may be ground to a very fine clay like powdery material, that is known as the gauze. Okay, and these gauze, these are frequently polished and striated by the fault movement. So a microbrexia that fills the wider zones of intense deformation, that is known as the myelinite. So what I mean to say is that the basic differences are very important. Okay, then, and what is the process behind that? Okay, so we have discussed about the fault breccia, that shows the angular fragments of different sizes occurring in a pulverized ground mass, and when the angular fragments are mostly microscopic, they are known as the microbrexia. And what is gauze? Gauze in an extremely fine rock floor which occur along the fault surfaces. And fault gauze may be sometimes be foliated in structure. Okay, and if we talk about the cohesive shear zones, rocks which form at sufficient depth are generally classified into two broad groups, that is the cataclasites and the myelinites. So it's very important for you to understand the cataclasites as well as the myelinites. So cataclasites are those shear zone rocks in which the grain refinement has taken place by the dominantly cataclastic process. The deformation has taken place by sliding and the rotation of the grains. Okay, so cataclasites is the process or those shear zone rocks in which the grain refinement has taken place by the dominantly cataclastic process, and the deformation has taken place by the sliding and the rotation of the rotating grains. And the deformation or the dominantly cataclastic process refining of the material, the refining of the grains, because of this process the cataclysite generally don't show any foliations. Okay, because the material is so powdered or so cataclysized that they don't show any type of foliation planes. And under the microscope, cataclysites show larger fragments of original rock which are set in a crust to fine grain metals. Okay, and if the rock contains 10 to 50% of matrix, that is known as proto cataclysite. Okay, the terms are very important, and the percent or the matrix percent is very important. So what are proto cataclysite? If the rock contains 10 to 50% matrix, it may be called as a proto cataclysite. And if the matrix is between 50 to 90%, the rock is called the cataclysite. Okay, so I will provide a paper or a paper which will deal with the graphs, sorry, a figure I will give you in the description box. From there you can download it, and it's very it will help you in defining the these types of rocks, their proportions as well as the their matrix proportion. Okay, that will help you in identifying the percent as well as the matrix component. And in an ultra cataclysite, the matrix is more than 90%. Okay, in proto cataclysite the matrix percent is 10 to 50%, and in the cataclysite the matrix percent is between 50 to 90%. And if matrix is more than 90%, those rocks are known as ultra cataclysites. Okay, then we will talk about the myelonites. So a myelonite is a foliated and lineated rock, foliated as well as lineated rock, which has undergone a drastic reduction in grain size by dominantly crystal plastic process. Okay, foliated and lineated rock which has undergone a drastic reduction in grain size by dominantly crystal plastic process. Okay, for objective type of purpose the definition is very important, because there are minute differences between the definition of the myelonites and the cataclysites. Okay, so remember the key terms. Okay, in myelonites the foliation and lineation planes are present, but in case of cataclysites or the cataclastic rock, the foliation planes, they are not present. Okay, because of the intense localization or the intense deformation. The variety of myelonitic microstructures and the different stages of their evolution are best found in the parent rock is fairly coarse grained, as in the granite or the quartzite. Okay, means the variety of myelonitic microstructures and the different stages of their evolution that are best found in some types of sub specific types of rocks, like coarse grained rock types like granite as well as the quartzite. And the increasing deformation, with the onset of the deformation, a myelonite shows a mortar texture with a very fine grain matrix, okay, surrounding large residual grains of the parent rock. Okay, as you can see in the figure. Okay, so this is the larger grain in white, and that is surrounded by the finer materials, as you can see in the definition. That is the full myelonite, so a mortar texture with a very fine grain matrix, means the matrix is very fine and that is surrounded by a large residual grain of the parent rock. Okay, so here if we talk about the the porphyroclast of potash feldspar that have been ambulatory extinctions, the myelonite foliation in the matrix sweeps around the porphyroclast, as you see in the diagram. The large grains, they are known as the porphyroclast, okay, or the residual megacrist. Okay, so these larger grains of porphyroclast of potash feldspar, they are known as porphyroclasts or the residual megacrist. and in a protomyelonite there is less than 50% of the matrix, same is the as we have discussed in the previous of the cataplasmids. In the protomyelonite the matrix percent is less than 50%. If the porphyroclasts of such rocks are distinctly lenticular, the rock may be called as the lenticular protomyelonite. Okay, and for rocks with 50 to 90% of matrix, the term myelonite or the orthomyelonite is used. Okay, the matrix is 50 to 90%, so then the term myelonite or the orthomyelonite is used. And ultramyelonites, the surviving megacrysts should constitute less than 10% of the rock. Okay. The process of grain refinement is associated with a large stretching along a newly formed foliation. The fine grain products of a large grain is drawn out as the thin seeds. Okay, and can often be recognized at tails of the porphyroclasts. These fine grain sediments, they are produced basically of the large grain, is drawn out as the thin seeds, and that can often be recognized as the tails of the porphyroclasts. And this is one of the reasons why myelonites often show a fine color banding parallel to the cystocity. Okay, and because of the extreme stretching, myelonites also acquire a prominent lineation. Okay, as we have already discussed that cataclasmids or the cataclastic rocks, they don't show any type of foliation or the lineations, but because of the formation of these bandings parallel to the cystocity, the extreme stretching, the myelonites, they show a prominent lineation. Okay, and shear zones can sometimes also contain a dark glassy rock, that is the known as pseudotachylite. It's very important for you to understand, pseudo means that it looks like a glassy material, but completely it's not a glassy material. Okay, that's why it's known as pseudotachylite. So they can sometimes contain a dark glassy rock that is known as pseudotachylite, and that is derived from the local melting of the rock by frictional heating. Okay, so pseudotachylite, that is derived from the local melting of the rock by frictional heating. Okay, so that is the process behind the formation of the pseudotachylite. And pseudotachylites may occur either as concordant veins. Okay, pseudotachylite, they can occur either as a concordant veins which are parallel to shear zone walls, or a discordant vein that is injecting the surrounding rock. Okay, and if we see it under the microscopes, it shows a angular rock fragments occurring in a glassy matrix, because that is a glassy material, so they show a angular rock fragments which are occurring in a glassy matrix. And the matrix may have undergone various degree of recrystallization, but unless it's deformed at later, it doesn't show any preferred orientation of the recrystallized material, because the matrix have undergone various degree of deformation, various degree of recrystallization, but unless it's deformed, means jab tak deformation nahi hoga at later stage, it doesn't show any type of preferred orientation of the recrystallized grains. The original glassy character of the matrix can be often identified by the presence of microlites, spherulites, or the vitrification structures. Okay, so how it can be identified, the presence of the pseudotachylite or that original glassy material? So that original glassy character of the matrix, that can be identified because of the presence of the microlites, spherulites, or the vitrification structures. Okay, and Shimamoto in 1989, he has suggested there
is a wide depth zone intermediate, which are intermediate between the shallow zone of brittle deformation and the deep lying zone of ductile deformation. Okay. So in this diagram, as you can see, that is the, this is the schematic diagram illustrating the fault zone model after the by the Shimamoto in 1989. So he defined this zones in two types, a seismic and the seismic. If we talk about the seismic zones, so these are known as the Gauss Brixia, cohesive cataclysmites, or the brittle and in the semi brittle conditions. But in types, if we talk about the aseismic zones, so they contains myelonite as well as the ductile shear zones. Okay, same is given here. Fault Gauss and fault Brixia form in the shallow part of the brittle zone, while cohesive cataclysite form under the brittle to semi brittle conditions. And he told the while most myelonites, they develop in the aseismic ductile shear zones. As we have discussed that myelonites, they are formed in the aseismic ductile shear zone. Some of them form in the semi ductile regimes, where the deformation occurs by a combination of the cataclysites, cataclastic and the plastic process. Okay. So this is our discussion, and the remaining part of the shear strength indicators and other some factors we will discuss in the next video. Thank you.